We may start. My name is Evgeny Malkovich. I'm working in the Math Institute of Sobolev here, and I'm specialist in differential geometry. Professor Dolgov asked me to give some small course about differential geometry and its application to general relativity. So the main idea will be to give some basic definitions that connects differential geometry, classical differential geometry, and Riemannian geometry too, and general relativity. So the probably the final point of this course will be discussion about some special solutions of Einstein equations that describe some different ways of how our universe can be as a geometrical manifold. So I'm planning to start with some very simple simple terms and simple propositions in differential geometry, and then I am going to generalize it to high dimensions and to give some analogies, examples, and so on. So this first lecture will be very simple, I hope. So at the end I will want to give you some questions just to understand your level, your average level. So if you have some questions while I will be talking, you can easily ask me. So probably this course will be only for physicians. So as I am a mathematician and a geometer, probably we can name some the same things on the different terms, you see. So probably there will be some misunderstanding. So if you think that some things are not familiar for you, you just interrupt me and ask your questions. I hope the main idea was to introduce some mathematical language. In that language, the general relativity is very simple and straight idea, theory that have no problems at all. So from mathematical point of view, general relativity is almost finished. So it is absolutely understandable theory. Okay, so I want to start from surface theory. Blackboard is not very good. So the basic definitions that appear in relativity at the first time appears here. So what is surface? Definition. Sigma is some subset in R3. R3 is Euclidean space with scalar product. And what is scalar product? Scalar product is just some function that usually in coordinates, if you consider this three-dimensional space, this is just some, yes? Is it okay? So scalar product, it's a very simple thing. You can understand when, for example, two vectors are orthogonal, it's when their scalar product equals to zero. Yes, so this is actually, this scalar product is the main object that will be generalized and to high dimension. So we have some set in three-dimensional Euclidean space, and this set called surface. If one of three equivalent condition holds, firstly you should fix for every point in sigma, there should be ball. Yes, ball with the center in this point. So this is surface. This is point P, and you consider a ball in three-dimensional space. This ball intersects your surface under some disk, yes? And, well, you should demand that this intersection should satisfy one of those three conditions. The first one will be that this set, this intersection, is some points in R3 such that there is a function of three variables, and this function is just annualized on this exactly set. But you must demand that the gradient vector at this point do not equal zero. Yes? Okay. This is, I will illustrate some examples to all of these conditions. The second one, this intersection can be considered as a graphic, as a graph of a function. So, but probably after renumerating. Example. We have sphere, this round sphere, and everybody knows that sphere of radius R is just some points in R3 such that module of X equals R. Yes? Mm. So if you don't consider some coordinates, you see that the sphere is very symmetrical set. It is very round, very symmetric, and you can see at it. You can view this from different angles, and basically you will see the same. But if you will present some coordinates, then situations changes. For example, if you consider this point, for example, I don't know, it have it will have some coordinates, for example, r cosine alpha, r sine alpha 0. Yes, the last coordinate z will be 0. This point lines on this equator, so it should have some coordinates of this type. Yeah. So this point cannot be, you can consider any small neighbor of this point, and you cannot describe this surface, the surface of the sphere, as a graph when z coordinate depends on as a function of x and y, you see, yes? Because if you will consider around this point, you can try to find solution of this type, and you see when the third coordinate equals to zero, you don't have one-to-one correspondence. Yes, and in the neighborhood of this point, you cannot find one-to-one map from the neighborhood of this point to disk as a function of x and y. So, but you can consider y as a function of x and z. Yes, if you consider y as a function of x and z, then it will be possible. So there are some yes.
If you take azimuth at that point,
yes,
to z axis, can't we eliminate x and y there?
Once again,
if you take azimuth angle,
you mean this?
Yeah.
Okay.
With respect to z.
To what?
Z.
To z. Z. Okay.
So now you can eliminate x and y there, right?
Yeah.
So now that z is equal to that function, this condition is not valid at that point.
So if you take this curve,
yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Only at this point, and probably there will be this point.
No,
yes.
Take a normal from the center.
If I take what?
Normal.
Normal.
Yeah. From the center origin.
From the origin here.
If you take find out the angle between z and that point P.
Okay.
So it will be a function of theta and.
No, you talk about spherical coordinates, yes, in angles. You talk about, so probably you mean this. So this will be theta, yes, and this will be phi, yeah?
So then no need to take x and y.
Yes, yes, it will be the third condition. So this is just some basic definitions that are easy to illustrate. I will illustrate this condition also in a minute. So the third one is just that this intersection is can be parameterized in the following way. So there is some function r. I'll continue here. There is function r that map from u. This is some open subset in R2, And this on this R2 we have coordinates U1 and U2. And this function goes to R3. So basically this is vector, three-dimensional vector, each coordinates of which depends on two parameters, U1 and U2. So just you have three functions. I must say that we will consider only smooth functions in our course, so there will be no questions like when our function differentiable or not, when it's continuous. It will always be very smooth, so we can differentiate all the functions as much as we can. But actually, three times will be enough almost every way. Okay, so and some additional condition to this is that these two vectors R1, that is partial derivative of this vector by this parameter U1, and R2 is a partial derivative of R by U2, they are not they are linearly okay. Yes, so you just consider they are linearly independent at point P, and so in small neighborhood of P also. Okay. Yes. So we have three functions. So it means three-dimensional vector. Each of these coordinates depends on two parameters, U1 and U2. And you consider two vectors R1 and R2 that gives as a partial derivatives. You demand that they should be linearly independent of each other. What geometrical sense have they? You can see the surface, you can see the point P, and you can see the tangent plane. Yes? Okay. Everybody understands what's tangent plane. So there will be two vectors R1. This is exactly R1 and R2. So these two vectors, they form tangent plane at every point of on the sphere, on the surface. Okay? Okay. So
two-dimensional plane.
Yes. So for now, for this first lecture, we will consider only two-dimensional surface that lies in three-dimensional space. Okay, two dimensions mean that this vector depends on two parameters. Yes, this is two degree of freedom. Probably yes. So this manifold, it is two dimensional, although it lies in a three dimensional space. Okay. So let us illustrate this. Why this condition should be hold? Because if these vectors can be linearly dependent, yes, then they won't form this plane. They will intersect, yes, and this plane will blows down in a one single line. Yes, so in this point they will the geometry will disappear. So it will become not plane. It will be line. But for some points, some small number of points, as I can say, on the surface, it is possible, because globally, usually you cannot parameterize your surface. So, if we have sphere, the well-known formulas is the following. You can parameterize sphere in the following way. Usually called this is a spherical coordinates. Yes. So actually here U1 and U2 they are theta phi, yes. So you see that r is a constant. This is the radius of a sphere, and it doesn't change. So you see that your sphere is two-dimensional because you have two parameters on it. Well, basically, I don't know what to say else. I just say here one thing that you see that, for example, theta is this angle, yes, and it change from pi over 2 to minus pi over 2, yes. We can consider this rectangle. Theta will be here, or I can change, for example, phi theta. This pi over 2 and this minus pi over 2. And phi is that angle, yes? So it's in this plane, it change from 0 to pi, for example. 0 to pi. If you consider a point inside of this rectangle, everything is fine. So you, what do you do when you consider this map? You just do with your rectangle what thing. You take this, yes, then you consider a cylinder, so you glue this side of the rectangle with that, yes? You glue this and you can see the cylinder. So this goes to that. You glue it because what? Because sine and cosine, sine of 0 equals to sine of 2 pi, yes? It means that you glue this side with this side. So this and this is glued. And after that, because here you multiply your function, here you multiply this function on sine, but no.
There you can multiply sine.
What? What?
X, r cos, pi cos theta, we can multiply with sine, and this one cos.
Once again.
R cos, pi cos theta.
Yes.
That one can multiply with sine.
Once again, I don't understand.
We can multiply with
sine, I'm saying. Multiply sine. With sine, yes. But no, we won't multiply. I mean that what do you do with this cylinder? You consider these circles and you put it in one point, yes? Because at this point you consider a theta, yes, on this side you consider theta, yes, and here you consider phi, yes. When theta goes to pi over 2, it's here and minus pi over 2. Your x and y multiply by cosinus. Cosinus of pi over 2 is 0, yes? So you consider, when you consider different circles here on your cylinder, you consider it of radius what? You can see this just too. As a circle with radius r cosinus theta, yes? When you fix theta and consider the phi as an angle. So this is a circle of radius r cosinus theta, yes? And phi is a parameter. So when cosinus equals to zero, you get a point. You get a circle of zero radius, yes? So when theta is equals to pi over 2 and minus pi over 2, your circles goes to just one point, and you will get your circle, your sphere, yes? So
and you want to say that the line theta is equal to pi half pi and the line theta is equal to negative half pi are glued together in the same way that the two lines
yes.
are glued together.
Yes. So this map, what does it do? It's not linear, and it's curve your rectangle. You should consider your rectangle made of rubber. I don't know. Yes. So what do? You put your rectangle. You glued these two sides, and then you have two circles up and down, and these circles you just glue in one point. This circle and that circle, and finally you get a sphere. So it means actually that on this border of this rectangle, this map is not very good.
In this cylinder, you meant to say this vertical component will be zero.
So vertical component is what?
Zero. If you consider only the circumference at every point, theta.
Yes.
So that vertical component will be zero.
Yes. So once again, this consider this cylinder as a set of circles, but circles of different radius. Of what radius? You consider this equals to r cosinus theta. This is will be new radius rho. And cosinus phi, and this rho sinus phi, yes. So here you have circles of different radius. It depends on theta. When theta goes to pi over 2, this radius will goes to zero. So you get circle, and in the end you have point. So all this circle that made of this side, it will go just to one point, this north pole.
And then it becomes a cone.
No, it's not a cone. If you will consider in algebraic topology, yes, it is there is different. Well, I don't want to talk about cone. We think that everything is smooth here, and you see that you multiply it, this point is smooth. It is smooth. Although it have some singularity, this singularity is not the singularity of the surface. Because every point on your surface is equal to another. You see, there is no difference between this point and, for example, that. This is some singularity of the coordinate system, of the parametrization. Yes. Question? Okay. So, For example, there is a different parametrization of a sphere. If you will pinch out this north pole, so if you take some needle, yes, and only one point, and you will throw it out, what will it be? To what geometrical object will it be equivalent? If you throw out only one point on a sphere, yes, to what it will be homeomorphic?
Plane,
yes. Why? What will be the correspondence? How does it called? You should know this, I think. So, never mind. This, consider only a circle, yes? And throughout only this point of it. It should be equivalent to what? To line. From infinite to infinite, yes? How you should consider this correspondence? You can find, you consider a line that goes from this point to this. And you just see that this point goes to that one, yes? This one goes to that one. So every point on this circle besides of this point, there is one-to-one correspondence of the points on the circle and on the line, yes? So this circle without a point is homeomorphic to one-dimensional line, yes? So how does it called? Do you know? It's called stereographic projection. Yes, as they are on the fist fuck. Stereographic projection. Stereographic projection. Really? What is your course?
Second course of
Okay, and what is your course?
First.
Huh? First?
First year of master
degree. Ah, of master degree. And you don't you hear about stereographic projection?
We didn't call it this
week. So I say that we. This will be the main problem, because, of course, these things you should know about this in the theory of function of complex variables. There should be some examples about this. So the sphere. The two-dimensional sphere, by the way, one-dimensional sphere is a circle, because this is vectors in R2, which lengths have length 1, yes? This is two-dimensional sphere. Two-dimensional sphere without a point is also homeomorphic to R2. By the same reasons, you consider the plane, You can see that every line that goes from this north pole, and it will intersect both plane and sphere into points, and you just, if you want to consider map from plane, you go from this point to that one, and vice versa. So this is easy. So it means that if in this parametrization, actually you have a line of a not very good points. This when this condition that R1 and R2 are linearly independent, doesn't hold on this set of your surface. This parametrization is better because you have only one singular point, but it is worse from another point of view. Okay, this is just some examples. And I forgot about the first condition. The first condition of the surface. Okay, I'll say that there is a theorem, and I won't prove it, that one equals two and equals three. That these three definitions, they are equal. Proof. Proof is done by some this implicit function theorem, I think. Yes? Теорема неявной функции. Implicit. I always change implicit and explicit. Explicit.
Explicit.
Okay. It was right. So this theorem, it is well known, one of the main theorem in mathematical analysis, and it states about when you can find when you can find one variable as a function of another variable, so you can change variables and put them, find different dependencies between them. And for example, additional conditions as R2 is not, and R2 and R1 are linearly independent, they will go as a condition to this theorem. They needed to use this theorem. So actually this is some formal application of this general theorem from mathematical analysis. It's not interesting. And in the first condition I said that this gradient should not be equal to zero. So now I'll talk about cone. If you consider a cone, it means the set where this function equals zero. Well, everything fine except when you are at the origin, yeah? So if you will consider this gradient, it will be equals to minus 2x minus 2y minus 2z. And you see that this point, it is belong to your surface, and if you put this point to the gradient, you will see it will be equals to zero. Yes. So, and you see that this point is special. It don't have some neighborhood that will be diffeomorphic to a disk. Yes. So it actually topologically, I won't say properly what does it mean, but if you will see it topologically at this point, you will see that it looks like two disks, yes, that glued, and it's glued by the centers. If you consider any another point, you can see, you can choose very small neighborhood that will look only like one disk. And if you consider a neighborhood of this origin, every neighborhood will look like that. Yes. So this is like two disks glued by the centers. Okay. So it means that this point is singular. But as we are going to study general relativity, probably I should give some additional notes. X, Y, and this I'll put T instead of Z. So when you look at this, you can see some, do you know what's Minkowski space? Minkowski? No? No, okay. This is the following thing. You can consider R12. This is space that have three coordinates, but the scalar product, is different. So, how should I put it better? So if you have this vector will denote as V. So the length of this V will be the following thing. It will be equal to T squared minus X squared minus Y squared. You just defined by force that the length should be calculated by this way. Of course, it means that this cone, yes, this cone will be those vectors in this space such that its length equals to what? To zero, yes? So there is vectors which length equal to zero. There are vectors with length below zero and greater than zero. Yes. So there are this cone. What? How does it calls? It calls light cone. Yes. In the general relativity, there is some directions. These directions, which are vertical, they call time-like because they near time, yes? And their lengths will be greater than zero because x and y almost zero and t is big. so this length will be greater than zero. Well, and so on. So okay, let's make some. So actually, you can consider the following thing. You can consider the new scalar product between, for example, vectors u and v. U1, U2, U3. You multiply it by this matrix 1 minus 1 minus 1. Yes, and then you multiply this vector by V1, V2, V3. Yes, if you will calculate the length of the vector in this scalar product, you get exactly the same, yes? So u by u is equals to u squared equals to u1 squared minus u2 squared minus u3 squared. And actually, you can define any scalar product by put here some different matrices. Okay, so actually the geometry in general relativity is Lorentzian geometry. So in differential and especially Riemannian geometry, you always consider that the scalar product have the following characteristic. If the length of the vector equals to zero, it means that the vector is zero itself, yes? But this is only in the Riemannian geometry. In Lorentzian geometry, it means actually that the scalar product can be considered in good coordinates as a sum of the squares. Yes, so this length will be considered as a square root of the sum of the squares. Yes, so x squared plus y squared plus z squared and so on, generally speaking. But if you consider some minus here, you will get some vectors that are not zero. For example, vector 1, 1, 0. And this length of this vector will be zero if you calculate length by this formula. So in general relativity, you calculate the length of your vectors by that product, by this scalar product. So there you have one time and three space coordinates. In time you have plus, and in space coordinates you have minuses, three minuses. So, and the light is just such a particle that in time space it moves with zero speed. Yes, the length of the speed will be zero. It's just only light. There are tachyons, yes, tachyon. Well, never mind. Okay. I think in theory there is a particle that can go to the past. Yes, because but it's unfortunately only in the theory. Next one. So what else can be example of the two-dimensional surfaces? For example, We call it usually sphere with G handles. So one handle, two handle, G handle. Actually, there is also a theorem in Riemannian geometry, and it said that any oriented compact two-dimensional surface have this form. You can consider a sphere with G handles, and it will be homeomorphic. Any oriented compact surface will be homeomorphic to such surface. Well, how can you get it? You can get a sphere, then you cut two discs from it, and then you glue this cylinder. Yes, and you get this thing. Actually, you can understand that is homeomorphic to torus. Torus usually denoted as T2, and this is sphere with G handles, and this is sphere with one handle. So this is some notations, only some notations. Also, how can you glue the torus? You can consider square and glue these sides with each other and that side with each other, just like in previous picture with a sphere. So when you glue this, you get cylinder. So this will be point that will be glued in one on the torus, on the torus. So you glued these sides, and this will be cylinder. After that, you glue this circle with that circle. You don't glue each of the circle into a point as we have done in the example of the sphere. You glue this circle with that. So you see, yes, this is a cylinder. You have this circle and that. You put them together, and it will be a torus. Well, you see, yes. So this way, pardon. This is that glued side, and here you have. You just glue, and you get a torus. It is the surface of the Duncan, yes, pointchik. You know Homer Simpson. Yes, Homer Simpson. Everybody knows him. Yes, you know this fat guy with yellow skin. Yes, he have just two hairs on his head. Well, he liked this thing. Yeah. Okay. If you consider, for example, if you want to glue these sides with opposite orientation, and you should draw this in this way, what will you get? So actually you cannot glue these circles in this side. You can define different, you should define opposite orientation or on the one of this circle, and only then you should glue. How you should do this? Well, actually you should put this end of the circle and goes to here to cut some disc in somewhere here, and to glue this circle from that side. You see, you will get a Klein bottle. Klein bottle. How usually you something like that. So you just make your bottle, yes, from the glass. Then you the neck of the bottle, you do it very, very long. Then you pinch the side of the bottle and put your neck inside of it, and it goes inside of the bottle and goes just right there. Have you seen in internet there is some guy made this bottle, actually made of glass? Don't you ever saw it? Well, I'll show you somehow. So this surface is this was oriented surfaces. These surfaces are not oriented. We won't study any not oriented manifolds, because usually you cannot define some global objects on it. Actually, you don't even have a good theory of measure on not oriented manifold. You cannot calculate the area of this surface, because you try to integrate, yes, you try to integrate, try, and then you came to the same point from the different orientation, yes? So you want to calculate the surface. It means you should integrate on the all surface. You begin to integrate, and there is a path. You will go on this path and came to the same point, but with different orientations. It means that integrals should annihilate each other. So there is no any good theory of differential forms on this manifold and so on. Yes, exactly. Doing in the Möbius list. Okay. Exactly. Do you know what will you get if you? So what is the Möbius list? You consider this rectangle, and you just glue two sides of this with different orientation, and that's all. Yes. You what will you get? You get something like that. Yes, you see that when you go from here to here, you just rotate slightly your list, and then you glue with different orientation. So actually, what is the edge of this surface? edge. You know what is edge? Yes. The edge of the disk is a circle. Yes. This is some points which neighborhood looks like half of the disk. Yes. So this is the edge. Yes. So actually, this is one circle in a space, but it looks like some spiral. Yes. So it is circle in the space, but it is not flat. For example, the edge of the cylinder is two circles. Yes, if you cylinder is what? Is when you glue the sides with correct orientations, you get cylinder. If you will glue the sides with different orientation, you will get the Möbius list. Yes. There is another surface which is actually important, but in the different science, called algebraic geometry. It is called projective plane. So this is Klein bottle. This is Möbius list. This is projective plane. What is it? You consider all lines that lie in three-dimensional space such that it contains the origin. So the point in this set is a line in three-dimensional space. So you consider any line that goes through the origin. So you want to imagine somehow this set. What do you do? You consider a sphere, and you see that any line that goes through the origin intersect your sphere in two points. Yes? So what should you do? You cut your sphere on two sides, up and down. Yes? So almost every point, for almost any point on the up half of the sphere, you have a point on the down half of the sphere. So you just forget about the down, about the down part of this sphere, and you have disk. So you consider that. Then you forget about this. Then you have just upper half of the sphere. It is easy to see that this is just a disk. Yes? When you just make it flat. What next? But you see that this point is exactly as this point. Yes? Because if you have some plane that intersect your sphere in the point of equator, it intersect in two points, and this one and this way. So you should glue this point with that point. You should glue this point with that point. This one with that one. Yes? And then you will get a projective plane. How should you do this? So now you should imagine, have some imagination. You make a cut. Now just I'll try to show you. You have a disk, yes? You make a cut from one side to the center, yes? So you take this side of the cut and this side, and then you just turn it twice, yes? So you fix the one side of the cut, and the other side of the cut you turn it that way, yes? So you have something like that. It is very hard to draw. So I cannot. I'll draw you the answer. The answer is projective plane, and it is drawn in this way. So this is RP2. How should you look at this picture? So if you see, this is the former cut. If you consider this disc with a cut, and you should rotate it by the side, you have two this circle will be double-sided, yes? So this circle will go once here and then once here. So this point will be just above this. You see, you make this circle, you multiply it length by two, yes? You make it longer by two. So this point will be just over this one, and you want them to glue, and you glue all this thing. So when there will be this cut, you glue, destroy your cut, and then this side of the cut will go to you should glue with that side, but after this double rotating, yes? So you see, so this cut, it goes here, this one plane, so you rotate it, and then you should glue this with this side, and you have self intersection of this surface. So it just another some funny science about this. And for example, there is Russian mathematician, his surname is Fomenko. He liked to draw a lot of these strange forms, and he's famous among mathematicians. Someone says that maybe he used some drugs and so on. So he have very strange fantasies and draw a lot of these strange forms. So this is just was example. So you get RP2 projective plane. It also is not orientable. And for example, there was a big science in the beginning of the 20th century, especially in German, there was a lot of questions. Can you immerse your projective plane in R3 in some special way? But this science just died at the present moment. So this was just an example, and this first lecture I want to finish with main definition. First, quadratic form. This is some classical notation. I think Gauss used notations like this. E is just scalar product of R1 by R1. G is R1 by R2. F is R2 by R2. So what do you have here? You might think of this object as a scalar product induced on the tangent plane by the scalar product from Euclidean space. How can I? So just this is some notation, and you should just, you had Euclidean product in three-dimensional space, yes, and you have your surface, and in every point P you have tangent plane, yes, and this tangent plane, they are different from one point to another. Yes, this is point P and this is point Q. So you have actually different spaces. This tangent plane is independent from that tangent plane. So you have different scalar products here and here. And so this scalar, two different scalar products, they are exactly as here. This is a matrix, it's symmetrical and it is positive defined, yes, but it depends on the point of your surface. It means that in every tangent plane on your surface you have different scalar products, and they was induced. So this is a notification for tangent plane at point P of your surface, yes. So actually you had standard Euclidean product, and you with its help you induce scalar product at every tangent plane on your surface. I just want to make some calculations to show you that this object is very natural. For example, you have a curve on your surface, and you want to calculate its length. Yes. You have point P and point Q, and you have some curve gamma. So gamma in 0 is equal to P, gamma 1 equals to Q. What does it mean? So actually gamma, this is the map that goes from interval I is interval of 1 and 0, 1 that goes to sigma, yes? This is our surface sigma, and you have curve on your surface, for example, azimuth on a sphere. And you want to calculate its length. What should you do? So actually, what is this? This gamma is actually r of u of t. How should you define some curve on your surface? You have this parameterization r, which depends on two parameters, u1 and u2. And if you want to have a curve on your surface, you should have some dependence of two parameters, u1 and u2, that depends on one parameter t. Yes? For example, this pi over 2 minus pi over 2 then by this spherical coordinates map you have a sphere, yes, and if you want, for example, if you will consider this dependence of theta and phi on t, this is a curve in plane u1 u2, yes, and by the same map it will go to what? It will go to some circle on your sphere, yes. So any curve on a surface can be parameterized like that, and you want to calculate its length. What should you integrate if you want to calculate length? Yes.
Length.
What?
2 points.
What 2 points? Once again, you go from this point to that point, yes, by some trajectory, yes, and you want to calculate the length of this trajectory, yes. What should you integrate to calculate this length? So you have some map from 0, 1,
Function of the path.
Well, you should.
In the 2 points.
Yeah. So once again.
It's already
we consider it's already parameterized. So for example, in this example, you will have r cosine phi that somehow depends on t, cosine theta that somehow depends on t, r sine phi depends on t, cosine theta depends on t, and r sine theta depends on t.
If it is in a horizontal view in one direction, you can take this r cos, this thing, r cos phi of t cos theta of t, t is equal to 1 to n.
It, yes.
1 to n. So if it is a horizontal view, you're not considering any vertical length.
Write down what do you mean. Write down what you mean.
Suppose this is x.
The yes.
Okay, so point P1 to P2. Okay. T1 to T2.
Yes, exactly.
So integral?
Yes, integral of what?
X of t. T1 to T2 dt.
No, it won't be a length.
This is the length only, no? At each point we are integrating. Distance between P1 to P2.
Yes, but this is points, they are lying on the surface.
No, if you take, suppose, T1, maybe X1, X T1, maybe.
Yes.
No. Of course, this the things that you integrate, it should depend on all this. On all this.
No, if it is an only horizontal.
Ah, if it's only horizontal.
This point. Only horizontal rotation. One direction. One D.
So you consider that theta is constant?
Yeah.
Yes, and or you consider that only phi is depends on T. No. Yes. So, but you have y, you have the second coordinate. So, if you consider that phi is a function of t, then y is changed too. So, don't you think that this integral should depend on these things too? No, this is not enough. So, try to think physically. What should you integrate to calculate the length of your path? You should integrate your speed, yes? So you know your speed at every point, yes, of the time. And you integrate your speed, yes? So if you integrate your speed, you will get your length. So the formula is the following. So the length of curve gamma that goes from pi to q, you should integrate from 0 to 1. This is the dependence of parameter t. You should integrate the speed of your curve. So it at every point of your curve you have this vector. It depends on every point, and you can, for example, you can go very fast at the beginning of your path, and then you can go very slow. So if you want to calculate the length, you should integrate. So this is very physical, I think. But you should understand what does this norm mean. Now I will show you how does it depend on the first quadratic form. So what is gamma dot? This is just velocity. Velocity of your curve. It is actually dr over dt. This is R1, and this is U1 dot. Well, it's okay, yes? You see that this vector, of course, it is tangent to your surface, because it is the velocity of a particle that goes along this curve that lies in your surface. You have curve and you have gamma dot, and it at every point this vector will be some linear combination of R1 and R2. This is exactly what it means. So actually you can write this in this way. This is coordinates in basis R1 and R2. Yes? So you at every point you have basis R1 and R2, but this basis, this frame, it change from one point to another. But in every point this velocity can be considered as a some linear combination of these two vectors R1 and R2. So, and if you will try to calculate the lengths, what is it? You should consider the square of the scalar product, so scalar square of this vector. What is it? This is U1 dot R1 plus U2 dot R2 scalar product on itself. What is it? It equals to U1 dot squared multiplied by R1 over R1, but R1 is E plus double U1 dot U2 dot G plus U2 dot squared F. So you see that this is exactly I want to note this vector as V. Okay, this V, this vector have two coordinates, U1 dot and U2 dot. So this actually can be written as V1, where 1 is just that matrix, EGGFV. So you know how to multiply vectors and matrices, yes? So this is exactly that. So you see that this first quadratic form, this is just the scalar product on the vectors, tangent vectors of your surface, and it was induced by the scalar product in R3. Yes. So this is actually the main object in differential geometry. It have different names. Classical name is first quadratic form. Now it is called metric or metrical tensor, and so on and so on. The main quality of this that it is defined to calculate the lengths of some curves on your manifold. So with this thing, with this matrix EGGF, you can calculate length and areas of the object that lines on your surface. And you can ask some different questions. For example, when this matrix is good, you can answer when it have some special properties and so on and so on. When next I will define some more geometric features like curvature and so on, but you should understand that the main object is this one. This is metric, and eventually for example, Schwarzschild solution to the Einstein equation is just a metric. Just a metric that defined in R1.3. It has some special features. It has some special curvature that defines by Einstein equation, but still it's just a metric which define how to calculate the lengths of different trajectories. So this is a geometrical point of view. Now, at the end, I want to So everybody who wants to listen this course, I want to get the idea what is your level, and I want you to answer these questions. They are very simple, so I can find some small sheets of paper. Please, if you don't have, I have. Questions. First one. They are very simple. If you sometime curvature of the plane R2 in R3 and sphere of radius R. If you know, then you just put down it. If you don't know, then okay, I will tell you sometime about this. What? Curvature of the plane, yes. And sphere.
What is word curvature?
Curvature is krivizna. So I just should know what you should be told. Yes, and finally I want to give some literature. So you answer this question, please, and I'll put some literature. The first one is, of course, okay. The blackboard is awful, actually. It's very hard to write down. It's in Russian, but okay, there are some Russians here. First one is Landau-Lifshitz, the classical theory of the fields. So actually, there will be some last paragraphs in this book. Second one is Misner-Thorne-Wheeler, Gravity. It is very, very big book, and it is useful. There are a lot of different formulas, and it is very good, I think. This more geometrical, Novikov-Taimanov, Modern Geometric Structures and Fields. And the last one, Buraga-Zalgaller. It is in Russian, unfortunately, but I think it is also very good introduction to the Riemannian geometry. Okay, give me your answers. That's all.